Georgina Cavendish, Duchess of Devonshire, appeared to have it all. She was wealthy, beautiful, popular, and loved by nobility and public alike. But her personal relationship with her husband, William, was complicated at best and scandalous at worst, for including her best friend as a third person. By 1790, Lady Elizabeth Foster, a woman separated from her husband and children, was living in the Duke and Duchess's household as the lover of William, but also as Georgiana's closest friend. It was a situation that scandalised polite society, and to this day, we have no real idea what Georgiana's feelings towards Elizabeth truly were. But in that same year, Georgiana gave birth to her third child, the boy her husband wanted for his heir on the 21st of May in Passy, France. He was named William George Spencer Cavendish and became Marquess of Hartington from birth. She already had two daughters by her husband, Georgiana, born in 1783, and Harriet, born in 1785. And by this point, Elizabeth and William also had two illegitimate children together. A daughter born in 1785 named Caroline St. Jules, and their son Augustus Clifford born in 1788. As she had given birth in France, her French friends, starting to feel nervous at the events in Paris, descended on the Cavendish household happy for the distraction. Marie Antoinette at that point was still allowed some freedom in her travels, and she was at Saint-Cloud for the summer when Georgiana and Elizabeth went to visit her with the children. She was a different woman, tired and fearful for her family, and she cried when they spoke of the Duchesse de Polignac, who had fled to Switzerland. When she would finally return home to England, Georgiana, who had always leaned towards the Whigs party, would find the politics of her country split down the middle over their feelings towards the French Revolution, especially as at this point no one had lost their head. Georgiana herself continued to support the Whigs, but her views were moderate. Although she believed the citizens should have rights, she also didn't think Parliament should do away with the monarchy altogether, but rather that one should support the other and in turn support their citizens. Everyone had been nervous about Georgiana's health leading up to the birth, so much so that the many debts she had gained through her gambling, around £20,000 at the time of little William's birth, were being paid off where possible by her friends and family, who were usually doing it without knowing the Duke knew nothing about it at all. Georgiana had a long labour that took more than a day, and for 2 weeks after going into labour, she was so weak that everyone feared the worst. But she made a full recovery, and in typical style, she began throwing parties to celebrate her new son as soon as she was able to rise from her bed. As with all her children, Georgiana absolutely adored little William, and he was barely out of her sight on the journey home to England. But more importantly for Georgiana, her son's birth also meant she could finally take a lover of her own. Although this came with the caveat that it remained secretive, something that seems hypocritical considering her husband and best friend's affair was well known amongst certain circles. But before that was the small matter of Georgiana's debts. She still hadn't admitted to the Duke how much she actually owed, but she had made it clear to Elizabeth that she loved her no matter what. And she had actually apologised to her for keeping the debts a secret. In return, Elizabeth loved Georgiana all the more for showing that their friendship was steadfast no matter what, and she swore to stand by her whatever the outcome. Elizabeth knew that when Georgiana's debt came out, especially as William had made her swear not to get into debt again, she might be able to persuade him to leave Georgiana altogether. But quite aside from the fact that her feelings wouldn't allow her to do it, Elizabeth knew that if she did, she would be hated by the Spencer family and rejected by most of society. Instead, she would stand by Georgiana's side and remain in their unusual menage a trois situation, safe in the knowledge that William was essentially all hers now. Interestingly, opposition to Elizabeth's presence in the Cavendish household came from Georgiana's mother, Margaret. Margaret had long since realised her influence over her daughter had been replaced by Lady Foster, and she now saw her as a rival for her daughter's affections. Margaret used her friendship with the children's governess, Selina Trimmer, to make the servants of the household treat Elizabeth as though she was merely a member of the staff herself. When she found out, Georgiana wrote to her mother and pointedly stated that she knew her mother's feelings towards Elizabeth, and that if she ever found out Selina was involved in any sort of conspiracy against her friend, she would remove her from the household. By November, little baby William was weaned, and Georgiana had no choice but to draw up a list of her creditors and what she owed. While she left out many debts, such as several thousand she had borrowed from her friend, the Prince of Wales, later George IV, and an annuity of £500 a year to a banker, the sum still came to the eye-watering amount of £61,917, today around £7.6 million. Georgiana's biggest fear was that the Duke, despite Elizabeth's insistence that she would do her best to make him come around to the huge sum of money, would leave her. This would separate her from her children, and as she asked her trustees to sign her settlement over to William, would also leave her destitute if they did divorce. The Duke did not make his decision quickly, and in February 1791, he was still deliberating when the stock market collapsed, sending Georgiana even further into debt. It could no longer be kept private, and the Duke's family broke their silence, openly stating they no longer wished to have anything to do with Georgiana, and that they thought he was a fool to keep supporting her. Rumours also swam about that she and her sister Harriet were involved in dabbling on the stock market with public funds through a political ally, but Georgiana vehemently denied these. On top of this, her sister Harriet fell severely ill and became paralysed down one side while also suffering fits. To this day, the exact reasons behind this are unclear, and even close friends didn't know at the time. Georgiana was anxious about her sister, and when Harriet also caught pneumonia, the family assumed she would die. Amazingly, the person who came to both of their rescues was William himself. Regardless of whether he loved Georgiana, a marriage of 15 years had inextricably tied them together. Added to this was her complete acceptance of Elizabeth, as well as the fact she was her best friend and of the illegitimate children they had created. He was also grateful to his wife for finally giving him a legitimate male heir. And to try and show his gratitude for all this, he rented a large house in Bath and moved in Harriet and her children alongside his own family. It was clear he forgave Georgiana, but also that the relationship between himself, Elizabeth, and Georgiana worked, and he saw no reason it could not continue. However, some outside commentators always thought Georgiana seemed to have accepted the situation only as a bargain for her misconduct with money, and that when she was not in Elizabeth's presence, she seemed happier in herself. We'll never really be sure either way, as many of those commentators disliked Elizabeth from the start due to her scandalous lifestyle. And part of Georgiana's glow could have been that she was once again pregnant, but not with her husband's child. Sometime after young William's birth, Georgiana had met a young politician called Charles Grey while holding a Whig society meeting at Cavendish House. He was involved in the same circle of political friends as Georgiana, including Charles James Fox, Richard Brinsley Sheridan, and the Prince of Wales, and at the age of just 22 had been elected as MP for Northumberland. It's likely the pair connected over their shared politics, but it wasn't long before they connected in other ways and they began an affair, although the exact date is unknown. They made little effort to conceal the affair either. When the Duke was away from Bath, Charles was often seen entering the house and he publicly sought Georgiana out at balls and parties, both of them seeming to have eyes for no one else. There were rumours that Georgiana had already had discreet affairs with others, such as John Sackville, the infamous Duke of Dorset, but her affair with Grey was practically public knowledge. Both her sister Harriet and Elizabeth had tried to warn her about being careful, but after so many years being left romantically adrift from her husband, Georgiana was too wrapped up in her new love to listen, and by 1791, she was pregnant with Charles's child. The three women tried their best to keep it a secret from William, but by her 6 month of pregnancy, Georgiana's stomach was too large to hide what was happening. As Harriet was still recovering from her mystery illness, the three women came up with a plan that her doctor would recommend Harriet travel to warmer climes, and Georgiana and Elizabeth would travel with her. They settled on Cornwall, but before they could put their plan into action, someone tipped William off that he might want to see his wife immediately. When he arrived in Bath, it obviously took him a single glance to realise what had happened. Harriet lay on a couch in her room, listening to the shouting and crying going on in the room next to hers as William confronted Georgiana. He called in Elizabeth and laid into her for covering up for Georgiana, and it was decided that the Duchess would travel abroad to conceal the imminent birth. It was that, or this time, he would publicly divorce her. Harriet and Elizabeth would both travel with her, Harriet's husband and their mother still believing they were only going to Penzance, when in fact, they would be going over into the continent. William was distressed by the situation for days afterwards, changing his mind every few hours. First, they would actually go south, then abroad, but without Elizabeth. Eventually, it was settled that they would go abroad, although the Duke had forbidden Georgiana to borrow any money, leaving funds tight. But worse than this was the ultimatum he had given her, which was incredibly rich considering his own position. William declared that he would not divorce Georgiana on two conditions. Firstly, that she cut off the affair with Charles immediately and had nothing more to do with him. And secondly, that once the baby was born, Georgiana would give it up for adoption. If she did not do this, not only would she be permanently separated from William, but he would also ensure she would never see her other three children again. It was a cruel ultimatum, born purely from jealousy, and completely unfair when his own illegitimate children had not only been accepted by Georgiana, but in the case of his daughter Charlotte, brought up by her. Charles Grey was inconsolable on both matters when she wrote to him to explain what was happening, and his replies were angry and upset with what she had agreed to. But in Georgiana's mind, she was not giving Charles up for William, but for her three existing children. By February 1792, Georgiana found herself in a small shuttered room in Montpellier, with only Elizabeth and Elizabeth's daughter Caroline with her, as the rest of her group had gone into Nice for the sake of Harriet's health. Her labour had started, and although she was only 34, Georgiana felt sure that she was going to die in childbirth. She wrote letters to her children, saying to little 2-year-old William, "As soon as you are old enough to understand this letter, it will be given to you. It contains the only present I can make you, my blessing written in my blood. Alas, I am gone before you could know me, but I loved you. I nursed you 9 months at my breast. I love you dearly." To her daughter Georgiana, she wrote, "One of my greatest pains in dying is not to see you again. But I hope that this letter will influence your whole life. I die, my dearest child, with the most unfeigned repentance for many errors. Learn to be exact about expense, I beg you, as the best legacy I can leave you. Never to run into debt for the most trifling sum. I have suffered from a contrary conduct." She charged all three children to always be dutiful to their father, loving to their grandmother, and kind to Elizabeth, and wrote up her will. The children had also, at some point, been told why their mother was abroad. The proof of this lies in her letters themselves, which her later Victorian descendants tried to alter by blacking out any mention of their illegitimate half-sibling. On the 20th of February, contrary to her personal proclamations of doom, Georgiana gave birth with no complications to a little girl, which she named Eliza Courtney. Almost immediately, the baby was taken from her arms and handed to a foster mother, who looked after her until she was old enough to travel over to England into the care of Charles Grey's parents in Northumberland at Fallowden House. Georgiana's return home was not instant, however. William's anger had not subsided, and 6 months later, tensions were still felt deeply. Harriet's husband, Lord Duncannon, wanted to return home to reconcile with his elderly father and was sick of living in hotels. But Harriet swore she would not be parted from her sister. Elizabeth wanted to return home also and made hints at her homesickness. Eventually, William wrote and said Georgiana should stay abroad until he came for her and that Elizabeth could do as she liked. Back in England, the children were desperate to see their mother again, especially as their father paid them little attention, instead leaving them at Devonshire House with their governess, Selina. Selina herself showed no hint of judgment, writing letters to Georgiana stressing how much she hoped the Duchess was well, and how she hoped she would return home as soon as possible. In an attempt to maintain a connection to her children, Georgiana made a plan to keep up with their lessons back home in her own way, learning Italian, practicing her music and sketching, and also developing a love of natural science which would fill her later years as well as help contribute to her children's education. She would then fill her letters home with this new knowledge, drawing maps and sketches of the places she visited. Every place her party moved to, there would be a ready pile of letters waiting. Her political friends, noble women who were close to her, the Duke of Dorset, and even the Prince of Wales, all sent her letters of support and love. It was pretty hard to hide that a separation of some kind had occurred between Georgiana and William, and everyone except his own family thought he was to blame for it. By the time Georgiana reached Lausanne in Switzerland, she had attracted several more friends travelling with them, with her charming personality and easy way of being. No longer throwing parties, Georgiana now studied mineralogy and geology in the morning and art and music in the evenings, all present delighted by being in her company. While in Italy, Georgiana also kept up with her scientific pursuits, hiking to the top of Mount Vesuvius to observe and study the active crater, taking boat trips along the coastlines and studying the ancient ruins. But Georgiana had also run out of money and was close to selling off some of her jewels, something her mother had warned against. She was still £20,000 in debt, but when her creditors approached her husband, he refused to even speak to them. Harriet's husband had just inherited the title Earl of Bessborough, and when he set off for London, found himself just in time to prevent both Georgiana and Harriet's names from publicly being on a list of defaulting debtors. Finally, on the 18th of May 1793, a letter arrived from William. He stated that he wished Georgiana to return home in the summer, and she set off with Elizabeth for the long journey home, leaving behind her sister Harriet, who was too ill to travel, and her mother Margaret to look after Harriet. While the two women kept each other company, Georgiana was anxious about what welcome she had waiting for her, as did Elizabeth. Georgiana declared in a letter to her mother that she would never again disobey the Duke, and was determined that nothing should ever again come between her and her children. But the drama wasn't over. When Georgiana and Elizabeth reached Ostend in Belgium, the French were at that moment forcing back the English army under the command of the Duke of York, Prince Frederick, during what became known as the Flanders Campaign. The two women pushed on under the bombardment of the city, everyone they met telling them to turn back. Luckily, they reached the port and Georgiana ran into an old friend, Lord Wicklow. He was just about to leave for Britain in his small yacht, and she managed to convince him to take herself and Elizabeth on board, along with all their servants and baggage. He agreed, but Georgiana would later recall her grief at having to leave behind some English refugees who ran up as the boat was leaving, pleading to be allowed on, although there was no more room. Finally, Georgiana and Elizabeth met with William and the children at Dartford in September. He even surprised his wife with the present of a new carriage with blue panels, and on the 18th of September, they travelled back in it to Devonshire House. Georgiana was overjoyed to see her three remaining children again, Charlotte no longer living with them as she had now married, but Georgiana was dismayed to see the change in them. Little G, as she called her daughter Georgiana, now had no confidence despite being a pretty and intelligent child. Little Harrio, or Harriet, had become snappy and cold towards people and disliked talking to others. But little William, or Hart as he was nicknamed, had changed the most. He didn't recognise Georgiana at all on her return, and he was so used to receiving little maternal affection that he thought any physical contact would result in a punishment rather than a hug. On top of this, an ear infection had caused the poor little boy to go deaf, although no one would realise it until later, and this meant he struggled to understand what was happening around him, and communication was difficult. Georgiana was forbidden to openly acknowledge her illegitimate daughter Eliza, although eventually an arrangement was made between the Cavendish and Grey families that Georgiana would be an unofficial godmother, allowed occasional access to her daughter. She wasn't allowed to write Eliza private letters that would not be seen by other members of the family, or to visit her at either Fallenden House or Cavendish House. On her few visits, Georgiana was upset that she wasn't able to lavish the loving attention her other children received, and the difference was painfully obvious. She gave Eliza little presents when she could, of tiny watercolour pictures, poems, and small things able to be wrapped in a little bit of ribbon and passed on easily. She often came dangerously close to slipping up and telling Eliza of her true parentage. Eliza, having been told, she was found as a baby on the Greys' doorstep and they had taken her in, viewing Charles Grey as her much older brother. She was treated with indifference by the elder Greys, and although they were never unkind, they also didn't go out of their way to make her life pleasant. The gifts and toys she received from Georgiana and her children were the only ones she was ever given. In some of her letters, Georgiana would drop small clues, such as hinting at her exile in France, stories about orphaned girls who found their true family, or saying how she would like to have Eliza by her side at one point when she was arranging her papers. Young Georgiana, Harriet and William sometimes went with their mother to visit Eliza, but were sworn to secrecy about her true heritage as much as Georgiana was, and all four kept their silence. Although Georgiana would not live to see her daughter reach adulthood, she would have been proud of how Eliza's life turned out. She would fall in love with a man named General Robert Ellis, who rescued her from her awful life with the Greys, and they would have a long and happy life together. Eliza was considered the most beautiful of Georgiana's children, and this, coupled with her sweet and gentle nature, won her plenty of friends. Georgiana settled into a sedate and quieter life than she had previously. William's gout had grown worse to the extent that he hardly ever went out, and as a result, neither did Georgiana, who chose instead to stay and nurse him. She received few visitors, choosing to spend her time either with William or her children. Charles Grey made it clear he wanted to return to their affair, but Georgiana had come too close to losing her remaining son and daughters, and she wouldn't give them up even for a man she loved. When she returned to society, she did not try to emulate her high fashion and riotous behavior of the past, instead keeping her head down. Wanting to reconcile with her husband, Georgiana threw herself into more worthy pursuits than she previously had. The Duchess had always been involved in politics, becoming a political activist years before in 1778, when she used her popular position to inspire other women to become involved in promoting the Whig Party. She actively campaigned for the Whigs, believing monarchy should be tempered by Parliament and the people, and would often hold political dinners, such as the one she had met Charles at. Her involvement was so great that during the general election of 1784, she was satirised as supposedly engaging in sexual favours and monetary gain in order to secure votes. Undaunted by this, Georgiana instead walked around London on election day, speaking directly with ordinary people and gaining blisters on her feet. But by the time she returned in 1793, Georgiana kept her involvement in the background, trying to heal the rifts which had grown in the Whig Party by inviting small groups of members to dinner at Devonshire House. But the divisions cut too deep, and the following year in 1794, the party would split in two. In the decades after her death, the Whig Party would disappear altogether. She also threw herself back into her scientific studies, having a back room at Devonshire House turned into a chemistry lab and collecting samples for mineralogy, occasionally attending lectures in London. Many noted scientists of the day not only praised Georgiana for her interest in science, but in fact noted that many of her observations and contributions were considered to be at the level of any learned male scientist, and her knowledge in the subject was considered genius. Her interest in minerals was so great that Georgiana would later create the Devonshire Mineral Collection at Chatsworth House, and she was involved with Thomas Beddoes, a physician and scientist, in establishing the Pneumatic Institution in Bristol. This was a research facility for the study of synthetic gases, and would help create the framework for modern anaesthesia. Georgiana also continued her interest in literary circles. In her youth, Georgiana had made several friends in the Blue Stocking Society and had contributed with several poems and stories, many of which were published. In 1776, aged just 19, she had confronted the image the public had of her with a poem directed from her own thoughts about who she really was compared to this public image. In 1778, it's thought that Georgiana then wrote a novel called The Sylph, about an aristocratic young girl who ends up in a loveless marriage and as a result is corrupted by society when she goes looking elsewhere for affection. The parallels were too easy to see, and although the novel was condemned for its lewd and explicit descriptions of society and sexual behaviour, it was also reprinted several times and devoured by the public. In private, Georgiana hinted that she was indeed the author. In 1799, in two newspapers and later in book form in 1800, a poem Georgiana wrote to her children called The Passage of the Mountain of St. Gotthard was published. The poem was based on Elizabeth and herself traversing the St. Gotthard Pass, a mountain pass in the Alps, on her long journey home to England in 1793. It would later be translated into French, Italian, and German. In 1796, Georgiana would suffer from an illness in one eye that caused it to swell up to twice its normal size. For a long time, she had suffered with bad headaches, but no one had connected this to anything severe. Her children were sent elsewhere, and her right eye was almost closed up with pus and swelling. Even by the standards of the time, the treatment carried out on Georgiana's eye by her physicians was horrific, with no anaesthetic and no real understanding of cleanliness. The eye was covered in ulcers, but they did eventually burst and her eye was covered up for several weeks to heal. The swelling went down, but Georgiana was left with deep scars over her right eye. It also left her unable to see out of her right eye beyond shapes, and her left eye also struggled and left everything blurry. Georgina put on a brave face and was optimistic about her recovery. For 2 months afterwards, Georgina didn't want to see herself, and when at last her children were permitted to see her, it was under strict instructions that they not mention anything about her eye. They cried when they saw her, and it allowed Georgina to crack her strong facade and cry with them. Everyone was impressed with how the Duchess had conducted herself, not once giving in to pity or expecting everyone to run around after her. But the experience changed Georgina. Her right eye now drooped, and she had become thin and quiet, preferring introversion to chatting happily with people the way she once had. She became too shy to visit her friends or receive them, and when she was once invited to stay for a few weeks with a friend, Lady Melbourne, Georgina backed out at the last minute when she heard there would be a lot of other people there too. In December that year, William was also a changed man. His uncle, Lord John Cavendish, had recently died and had been something of a surrogate father figure for him since he had been orphaned at the age of 11. It hit him hard, and when he returned from the funeral, he cried in Georgina's arms, something he had only done twice before. In the same year, he had lost his father figure, thought he was going to lose his wife to illness, and he had also nearly lost Elizabeth, who had briefly had her head turned by a previous lover, the recently widowed Duke of Richmond. All William wanted as he became middle-aged was to settle down and live a calm life with Georgina and Elizabeth. Over the years, what had begun as an uncomfortable living situation between a married couple and the other woman had grown into a deeply respectful and caring relationship between the three of them, albeit in different ways. By January 1797, Georgina was also upset to find out she had miscarried very early on in another pregnancy. It would be her last. Georgina even managed to make friends with the wife of her previous lover. Charles Grey had, after many years of trying to persuade Georgina to return to him, finally married Mary Elizabeth Ponsonby in 1794. Georgina invited the couple to Devonshire House and became very close to Mary, making friends with her almost immediately. The closeness of the two women allowed Georgina and Charles to smooth over their own relationship and allow it to become a new friendship of its own. Although it's almost certain, the pair never really fully lost their feelings for each other. Georgina also began to mature, and she became less afraid of saying no to people or being more direct about how she felt, which in turn made her feel empowered in her everyday life. She even acknowledged that losing her sight in one eye had allowed her to stop worrying about her looks and whether people liked her well enough. An emotional fling through letters also occurred around this time, with a 60-year-old Whig politician named Sir Philip Francis falling in love with her. And although this cooled off after a few months, it restored her confidence. But old habits die hard, and somehow Georgina was still able to rack up debts. She also still could never bring herself to be honest with William about how much she actually owed, and as a result, friends and family would every few months get a pleading letter from her asking for help with repayment. In 1800, now in her early 40s, Georgina was able to oversee the coming out of Little G, who was now 17 years old. Invitations began to come in from noble ladies anxious to invite the renowned Duchess of Devonshire and her eldest daughter to their parties, and Georgina finally allowed herself to accept some of them. To mark their daughter's first season, William and Georgina spared no expense, holding a lavish ball and dinner at Devonshire House and inviting everyone in society. Few turned the invitation down, and the ball was a great success, Georgina successfully reminding those present of the soirees she had held in the old days. On the 22nd of May, the entire extended family gathered at Devonshire House to be part of Little G's presentation at court. There was great bustle and excitement that morning as ladies rushed to get ready. The Duke couldn't sit still and the Duchess worried over getting her daughter's court dress right as bouquets arrived constantly from well-wishers. Little G did her mother proud, curtsying at the right moment and remembering to walk backwards out of the room without tripping over her own skirt. This was followed up by a few months of elaborate balls to which everyone was invited in order to keep politics out of it. And by July, the season was over, and Georgiana felt her daughter's coming out had been a great success. Plus, there were two possible suitors for her hand. One of these was George Howard, Lord Morpeth. Georgiana liked him, and he was a sensible, steady person, although she thought he was a little pompous. He was invited to a party at Chatsworth House later that year, and William encouraged Little G to agree to a marriage by offering her a dowry of £30,000. She finally accepted an offer of marriage from Howard, and they were married on the 21st of March 1801 when she was 18, moving to London together. Georgiana missed her eldest daughter deeply, but she threw herself into once more being a high society hostess, planning parties and dinners, and once again sinking into the lore of gambling. This continued until March 1806, in which Georgiana suddenly fell ill with jaundice. When Margaret received a letter from her daughter asking for £100, she assumed that the story of the jaundice was brought on by money difficulties rather than physical ones. At first, Georgiana's doctors thought she might have a kidney stone, especially when she seemed to improve for a few days, but then on the 22nd, she rapidly went downhill. Crowds of people came to visit, sensing this was probably serious this time, and Margaret went to be by her daughter's side, along with Georgiana's children, her sister Harriet, William, and Elizabeth. On the 26th, Georgiana suffered a fit that lasted for over 8 hours. The doctors were stumped, and what they didn't know was that she was suffering with an abscess on her liver. By the 29th of March, it was obvious that Georgiana did not have long left, and it was now an effort for her to talk. Her husband William was distraught. Her pain was severe, and it was as much agony for those around her to see her go through it. But finally, peace came to her at 3:30 in the morning on the 30th of March. Her loved ones remained by her side until the end, and all were delirious with grief. All those who had known her were inconsolable, and the Prince of Wales summed up the general feeling by declaring, "The best-natured and the best-bred woman in England is gone." Thousands of ordinary people made their way to Piccadilly to the Cavendishes' townhouse to pay their respects. On the 5th of April, her coffin, which had been left open for close mourners to say their final farewell, was shut and travelled to Derby, where Georgiana would be laid to rest in the family vault at St. Stephen's Church, now Derby Cathedral. Georgiana had certainly lived a full life and then some. Her personal life is probably the most famous aspect of what we know about her, and being part of a relationship in which there were openly three people involved was certainly unusual for the 18th century. She charmed everyone she met, and barely anyone had a bad word to say about her, except probably those she owed money to. Georgiana also left behind an enduring image of her as the party girl, the it girl of her time, and she bolstered this with gambling, drinking, and general mischief. But she was a lot more than just this image as well. She was a kind and generous friend, sometimes to a fault, to the extent that she could not bring herself to not love Elizabeth Foster, even when she knew William was having an affair with her. Her personality, full of love, was even more clear in the relationships Georgiana had with her children, lavishing care and affection on them, even when she was physically parted from them. But Georgiana was also an intellect of her time, becoming an avid scientist and contributing herself to the greater knowledge of the time. She was also a political force to be reckoned with in her own right, and as she grew older, she came to realise it was not her ability that held her back from a career in politics, but merely the fact she was a woman. Even the literary world was graced by her works, and her feelings and commentary on her life are captured in both prose and poems. Her involvement in politics and her attempts one summer at creating a female auxiliary corps also encouraged many women of all classes to grow their own voices and create change for themselves, a process that started in earnest around the time Georgina was alive. However people felt about her, Georgina left her mark on the society of her time, her family, and everyone who ever spoke to her. And even today, even when we hear about the scandalous, frivolous lifestyle of her youth and about how she frittered away money, the charm, kindness, and warmth that comes across in Georgina's letters and actions still has the power to make people today fall in love with her all over again. If you enjoyed this video, don't forget to like and subscribe so you don't miss any new documentaries.